I will be speaking both Malayalam and English. ഇപ്പോ ഇന്ന് ഇന്ന് ഞാൻ ഇന്നത്തെ സെഷൻ സംസാരിക്കാൻ ഇംഗ്ലീഷും മലയാളത്തിലും കൂടി ആയിരിക്കും. കാരണം ഇന്ന് ജോയ്ദീപ് സാറ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷിലാണ് സംസാരിക്കുന്നത്. പക്ഷേ ഞാൻ എന്നോട് ആരെങ്കിലും എന്ത് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഉണ്ടെങ്കിലും മലയാളത്തിൽ ചോദിക്കാം. ഇൻ കേസ് ഞാനത് ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിൽ ഞാൻ ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാം. അപ്പോൾ എനിക്കും സാറിൻ്റെ അടുത്ത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് സംസാരിക്കും എന്തെങ്കിലും പ്രസിംഗ് വളരെ ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ഈ സെഷൻ കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ചോദിക്കണമെന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ എന്നോട് ചോദിച്ചാൽ മതി, ഞാനത് ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് കൊടുത്തോളാം. അപ്പോൾ ഇന്നത്തെ സെഷൻ സംസാരിക്കാൻ പോകുന്നത് ഫിക്സ്ഡ് ഇൻകം, ഡെറ്റ് മ്യൂച്വൽ ഫണ്ട്, പിന്നെ അതിൻ്റെ സേഫ്റ്റി ആസ്പെക്ട്സിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ടാണ് നമ്മൾ സംസാരിക്കാൻ പോകുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ ആദ്യത്തെ സെഷൻ നമുക്ക് സാറിൻ്റെ വക ഒരു പ്രസൻറ്റേഷൻ ആയിരിക്കും. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഇപ്പോൾ ഞാനും സാറും കൂടി ഒരു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ആൻസർ സെഷനിലേക്ക് കടക്കും. അതോടൊപ്പം നിങ്ങളുടെ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസും എന്തെങ്കിലും ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ചോദിക്കാം എന്നുള്ളതാണ് നമ്മുടെ ഇന്നത്തെ സെഷൻ്റെ ഒരു ഒരു സ്ട്രക്ചർ പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ. അപ്പോൾ ഇതിലേക്ക് കടക്കുന്നതിനേക്കാളും ഉപരി ഇപ്പം നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ഈ സമയത്തുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അപ്പപ്പോൾ ചാറ്റ് റൂമിൽ ചോദിച്ചാൽ മതി. അപ്പോൾ ജോജി സാറ് അതനുസരിച്ചിട്ട് സംസാരിക്കണമെങ്കിൽ സംസാരിച്ചോളും. അതല്ല ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ലാസ്റ്റിലേക്ക് എടുക്കണമെന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ആ സമയത്തും എടുക്കാനായിട്ട് ശ്രമിക്കും. അപ്പോൾ എല്ലാവർക്കും മണി ടോക്സ് വിത്ത് നിഖിലിൽ വീഡിയോ കാണുന്നതിന് നന്ദി. നിങ്ങളുടെ എല്ലാവരും ഈ വീഡിയോ കാണുന്നതിൻ്റെ പേരിലാണ് അടുത്ത വീഡിയോ ഇടാനുള്ളൊരു ഇൻസ്പിറേഷൻ കിട്ടുന്നത്. സോ വി വിൽ ബി കണ്ടിന്യൂയിങ് ഡൂയിങ് ദ വീഡിയോസ് റെഗുലർലി. ആൻഡ് ദ സെയിം ടൈം every 2 weeks we will conduct a workshop like this with experts and specific topics we will be talking. Today we will be talking about fixed income, debt mutual fund and safety. So today we have a speaker. Today actually we are really blessed to have a speaker like this, because a person like Joydeep sir, it's a corporate trainer, author, because one thing which I always respect is the people who can write books and articles. And that too makes sense, whole difficult task in a very common man's language they put it to us. So he's a famous, very known columnist and author, and he has been in the industry for 25 years, and he has been almost half of his career, 13 years he's worked with the BNP Paribas under wealth management department as a senior vice president in advisory desk fixed income. So in order to talk about fixed income category, we don't have anyone better than this in India. Okay, then we have Joydeep sir's presence is always there in almost all the leading publication in India, be it Mint, Money Control, Financial Express, ET, Economic Times, everywhere we can see his articles. And when it comes to his books, he has written 4 books related to fixed income, then talking about how to manage wealth in families and middle income class, and financial planning and wealth management concepts in a very, very easy way he has written. So these books are available in the market, in so you can refer this. And the same time he has been delivering trainings for all this financial institution, be it a mutual fund, be it any NISM, all these places he is helping people to get trained, and he's imparting his knowledge. Then another achievement he has in his feather is that he has been selected as a 100 most influential BFSI leaders in 2019, and 50 most influential financial service marketing professional in 2019. So these are like a small introduction I can talk about Joydeep sir. And today he will be going to educate us fixed income and debt mutual fund and its safety, because safety is a very important thing. So I welcome with a lot of respect and love Joydeep sir for all of you. Sir, you can take over from here.
Nikhil, nanni for the wonderful introduction, and suprabhatam to all the participants, and thanks for inviting me here, and thanks to all the participants for joining. So we'll start the session now, and the format of the session will be that initially for like half an hour, 45 minutes, I will make my presentation and I will talk one way. Now, even in this first part, like half an hour, 45 minutes when I'm talking, even then I want to keep the session participative. So the format will be that in this phase, Nikhil would put you guys on mute. You cannot talk as such. However, the chat box is on. So during the course of my talk, I will throw questions at you. And when I keep on throwing questions at you, you respond by typing in the chat box. I can see the chat box. And after my one-way talk monologue is done, then Nikhil will open the conversation for all of us. Right, Nikhil?
Yes.
Yeah. So Nikhil, so please make me the co-host. I have to share my screen now.
Yeah. I have even once. Yeah, you are co-host now, and the PPT you can share. I have enabled multiple.
So I will start with my screen share. Just a minute. I'm just trying to share my screen. Yes, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'll just get the chat box in just a second. Yes, I have got the chat box also. And should I enlarge this thing, my presentation, my PPT? Anikil? Okay, let me enlarge my PPT. That will be easier for participants to see. Right. So as Nikhil said in the introduction, our topic is fixed deposits, debt mutual funds, and the safety aspect of it. So we will cover these aspects in today's session, the safety aspect of deposits, the rate offered in deposits. Now, why have I put rate within quote? There's a reason for it, because the rate itself gives you an indication of the risk level or the safety aspect of the deposits or the investments. Debt mutual funds, we will briefly touch upon, and tax efficiency. Like someone was raising the point earlier, there is a tax efficiency in debt mutual funds over a holding period of 3 years. So we'll discuss that also. So now starting off with the safety aspect, the concept of safety. Now, if you have heard this concept earlier, return of capital and return on capital. Very language-wise, English-wise, not much of a difference. But from your point of view, from your perspective, there is a big difference. Return of capital and return on capital. What does it mean? Return of capital means you invested rupees 100. You got back rupees 100 on maturity or when you redeemed. Like if it is a mutual fund, you can redeem. So on maturity or redemption, you got back rupees 100. That is the return of capital. Whatever you invested, you got it back. Return on capital is the return. So on that rupees 100 investment, you earn rupees 6 or rupees 8 or rupees 10. That is the return on your investment. That is the concept of return of and return on capital. So, so like I said earlier, the session is participative. So in this phase, you participate by typing in the chat box. So you can see something on screen, which one is more important, return of capital or return on capital. So I would request you to type in the chat box. Both are important, return on capital, return on capital, return on capital. Anybody else? Both. Return on capital. Okay. So it is, okay, one person says return of, mostly return on capital is important. So the purpose of my today's session is to get your concepts clear. So you are investing your money for getting returns, which is fair enough. But if you say, I mean, not everybody, at least some people say return on capital is more important than return of capital. So it is like this, if an investment is giving you a higher return on capital, let us say one is giving 20% return and one is giving 5% return. 20 is higher than 5 and you are happy to get 20% return. However, if that investment is more risky and your initial rupees 100 is for some reason is at stake, you don't mind that, right? So it is like you invest rupees 100 in the 20% return wala thing, you get rupees 20 that return. However, you're getting back rupees 100 itself becomes a question. You don't mind it, right? Just to get your concept clear. So to get your concept clear that I prefer rupees 20 return over rupees 5. So I'm investing here and I will be happy if I get my rupees 100 also back. If I do not get back my rupees 100, I'm okay with it. Just to get the concept clear. Are you getting me what I'm trying to say? So it is your money, your investment, and you have to be clear why you are making the investment. It is only for the investment. Does not matter you are getting your capital back or not back. Okay. Next one. So these are my points on this. You are investing your hard-earned money. Now, defaults don't happen every day. Only once or twice we hear of some defaults. Like, for example, there are some cooperative banks. Like one big case recently was, not recently, but it's been some time. A bank called PMC, Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank. They are in trouble. And there are some other cooperative banks that have been in trouble. In mutual funds, you would have heard of certain defaults, like ILFS Group defaulting, DHFL being in trouble. Reliance Anil Dhirubhai Group being in trouble. But these things don't happen every day. Sometimes these things do happen. There's a question, if the capital reduces, the returns will shrink as well, right? Yes. So I think one person has got what I'm trying to say. If you are investing in a safe 5% wala investment, at the end of whatever 1 year or whatever your investment period is, you get back rupees 105. If you invest a 20% wala thing, whichever investment it is, and let us say for the sake of argument, you get back rupees 20. And if you do not get back your capital, how much do you get back? 20. So probably getting back rupees 105 is better than getting back rupees 20. I repeat, probably getting back rupees 105 is better than getting back rupees 20. So do you all agree with this? So we can discuss further on this. So when I say better to stay in the formal system means, you know, there are regulators like Reserve Bank of India, there are regulators like SEBI, Reserve Bank regulates banks, SEBI regulates mutual funds, and that is the formal system. And there are certain informal investments where people get together, they collect money, which they invest the money, which may or may not be regulated. Not to say they will default, but there is a higher risk in those informal arrangements. So as an example, I've said, bank deposits are better than plantation schemes or collective investment because banks are regulated by Reserve Bank of India and they are that much better regulated. So that way, your money is safe. Within banks, there are PSU banks, nationalized banks. There are leading private sector banks, and there are non-RBI scheduled banks. In the sense, maybe some small cooperative kind of thing in some corner of the country, which RBI is not even aware of, those things are there. So better to stay in the formal system and in the regulated system. Now, when I say formal system is better, not to say that formal system is 100% safe. Like I said, this PMC bank, Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank, that is in trouble. So things do happen in the formal system as well, but at least there is a regulator who would step in, and that way it is that much better. And for market-oriented investment, so market-oriented investment is an example, mutual funds, they invest in the market on behalf of the unit holders. So that is a market-oriented investment. As against contractual return means like a deposit, bank deposit or some other deposit, you know upfront what your return will be. That is a contractual return thing. So for market-oriented investments, SEBI-regulated entities are better. So mutual funds, portfolio management services, These are regulated by SEBI. And again, last point, mutual funds are better than informal pools of investments. Why so? In an informal system, just like, you know, somebody says, I'm an investment manager, but I'm not registered with SEBI. He is pooling money from people, investing. So if something goes wrong, of course, the legal system is there, the court of law is there. You will be even entering initially into a legal agreement. All those things are there. In a SEBI-regulated system or SEBI-regulated structure, there is the additional thing, if something happens, the regulator also will step in. Okay, so now all these quizzes, you just type in the chat box. So you can see the question in the thing on the screen. Between these two investments, which one is better? Guaranteed or non-guaranteed? Okay, Vinod says guaranteed. Guaranteed, I think. Guaranteed, okay. Others, please respond. Someone says based on risk appetite. So I have to understand this later. Okay, people. One person says non-guaranteed. Good, good to have different views. So guaranteed. So I think, again, NIMI guaranteed, RESMI guaranteed. So I think most people are going towards guaranteed investments. Depends on what is the risk. Ajit, wonderful. Depends on what is the risk to guarantee. Okay. So, so far, most, Murukesan says non-guaranteed. Okay. So most people are preferring a guaranteed investment. So now let me throw the next question at you. So fair enough. You're investing your hard-earned money and you want guaranteed investments. So for those people who prefer guaranteed investments, one further question. Next quiz. There are two investment options, hypothetically. In one investment option, you are investing with Nirav Modi, and it is guaranteed by Mehul Choksi. It's a guaranteed investment. Mehul Choksi is guaranteeing it, that if Nirav Modi does not pay, I will pay. As against that, there is a non-guaranteed investment with Mukesh Ambani. So which one do you prefer? Ambani, Mukesh, B, second. Ambani, obviously, good. So I would like to visit back to all those people who said guaranteed investment is better. So I'm trying to get your concepts clear. First of all, what is a guarantee? I have seen this concept across India. Can I guarantee my own investment? As in, if you are giving me your money, can I guarantee my investment? No, I cannot guarantee my investment, because if that were possible, then even if I am a thief or criminal or whatever, I will say, I'm issuing you a bond, you give me your money, and you say, what is the safety? I say, it is guaranteed. I have guaranteed my this thing. I will say, it is 100% guaranteed, 200% guaranteed. But I am a thief or criminal or whatever, I don't have any money. But if you are allured by the word guarantee, then you will not look at my profile, who am I, what is the value of my guarantee, you will just give me your money. So think of it. So like initially, most people said guaranteed. Afterwards, people are going towards the non-guaranteed investment. So first of all, Mukesh Ambani cannot guarantee his own investment. As in, if you're giving money to him, he cannot say, I'm guaranteeing my investment. It has to be guaranteed by somebody else. So I think now you have got my point. You have to understand what you are doing. And you know, some attractive phrases, catchphrases like guaranteed, you should not easily fall for those phrases. Okay, next one. Given a choice between higher return and lower return deposits, you are likely to choose the higher return one. So why would an entity give you a higher return? Again, I will show you the quiz and you can type in the chat box. When a bank or an NBFC, NBFC stands for non-banking finance company. When a bank or NBFC or chit fund or any entity with whom you are depositing if they are giving you a higher rate than some other bank or NBFC or chit fund or plantation scheme or any other entity, why are they giving a higher rate? Option A, they like your face. Option B, they want to do a good deed for mankind. Option C, they are unable to get deposits at a lower rate. Yes. So I think most of you have got it right. Now, on this also, I have seen confusions across India. So you can type in the, I'm just verbally asking something. You can type in the thing response in the chat box. So let us say on a given day, for a given purpose and for a given tenure, I go to a bank asking for a loan. Mukesh Ambani goes to the bank, same bank, asking for a loan, same tenure and similar purpose. Who do you think will get a lower rate? I repeat, I go to a bank asking for a loan for a particular tenure, for a particular purpose. Same day, Mukesh Ambani goes to the same bank asking for a loan, similar tenure, similar purpose. So who you think will get a lower rate? Yes, Mukesh, Ambani, the one whose financial profile is good. Right. So now you're getting it right. Which means if I take a loan from the bank at a higher rate, it means my financial profile is not as good as Mukesh Ambani. In fact, I have seen, I don't know how, but some people have a thing. Some people even say that Mukesh Ambani, not you guys, but I'm seeing other places in India. Some people even say that Mukesh Ambani will have to pay a higher rate because his profile is better. I don't know where they get this concept, but yes, some people even think that way. Because if that were the case, better profile means a higher rate. Had that been the case, let us say then Mukesh Ambani gets a 10%, I get at 5%, if that were the case. That means a beggar or a thief would get at 0%. So these concepts need to be clear. So you guys got it right. So now I'm coming to the presentation as such. I'm differentiating what is called fixed income investment or debt investments broadly into two parts, contractual and market related. So the first one is to my left, what I'm calling contractual, some people call it guaranteed. Now I don't use the word guarantee. Contractual is what? Let us say you put your money in a bank deposit or some other deposit where you know upfront that I invest here and I will get this much, whatever, 5%, 10%, 8%, whatever. And that I call contractual. Guarantee means if any deposit is guaranteed by somebody else, in the sense if he or that entity is not able to pay, I will pay. That is a guarantee. So any deposit is a contractual thing. And market related means, let us say a mutual fund scheme, you're putting money in a mutual fund. Your return on that investment depends on the market movement. Okay. So that was the safety aspect. I'm now moving to the why debt? The reason is there's a belief, and it is correct, that equity gives higher returns. Yes, equity does give higher returns. And that way there's a preference for equity, which is correct. So then what is the argument for investing in debt in your portfolio? Allocation leads to optimum returns. Allocation means allocation to, let us say, there are multiple asset classes. Let us say there are three: equity, debt, gold. So instead of investing in equity only, it is better to allocate to all three in a certain proportion: equity, debt, and gold. Equity is a higher volatile investment. So as an example, January to March 2020, the equity market corrected by 40%. An example of volatility. So for investing in equity, you have to have a long horizon and you have to have that risk appetite. And if you don't have that, debt is less volatile, so you can invest in debt. So debt gives relatively stable income. And there is a concept of laddering. Laddering means matching your financial goal. Like you have various financial goals of 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. And in debt, you can earmark your investments like 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. You can do that in equity also, as in this equity investment is for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. But then what happens there is in equity, 2 years is a short horizon. You should invest for like whatever, 5, 10, 15, 20 years, longish horizon. And if it is a financial goal of, say, 5 years, 10 years, and you're investing in equity, it may so happen that in the initial part, the equity market rallies, but your horizon is like 5 or 10 years, you don't withdraw. And towards the end, the market corrects. In that case, what you will take home is less than the peak. So if you invest rupees 100 today and the market rallies, 100 becomes 140. And towards your requirement, towards your maturity or redemption, that becomes, say, 130. Then you will take home 130, not 140. Whereas in debt, if you can match the maturity of your investment, let us say investing in a bond or some other thing with a maturity, defined maturity, whatever the thing is, on your financial goal, after those 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, you will be taking home that much money, which means as on that date, you are doing away with the market volatility risk at that point of time. So just to show you the points once again, what are the arguments for investing in debt vis-a-vis equity, allocation or diversification, risk-adjusted returns. This means volatility. So financial theory, investment theory says that two investments, even if they give the same return, if one investment is more volatile than the other, then on a risk-adjusted basis, that is less effective or less beneficial for you because that subjected your money to higher volatility, more of ups and downs. Whereas if something has been going up more stable manner, that is better for you because that is not giving you sleepless nights. And laddering we just discussed. And for allocation diversification, one is of course the standard argument of saying, don't put all your eggs in one basket. That's of course there. Plus the other argument is that all the three assets, like we're discussing only three assets, equity, debt, gold, should behave in a different manner. Because had it been, if everything is behaving in a similar manner, then you are not really diversified. So if in a given set of conditions, if all three are rallying, good for you. For another given set of conditions, if all three are falling, if all three are correcting, it's not good for you. So the essence of diversification is these three, like equity, debt, gold, should behave differently for a given market condition. And that is the argument for allocation or diversification to all these three. Okay, my next point, the argument is equity gives higher returns. Yes, equity does give higher returns than debt. For a ballpark comparison, if I have to look at the historical returns from equity and look at the historical returns from debt, you can throw some numbers in the chat box. Over the last 23 years, that's just a ballpark, how much has equity given annualized basis? CAGR means annualized. And how much has debt given annualized? Just any number, doesn't matter, right, wrong. You can just put in some number in the chat box. Okay, good. Resmi says 15 and 8. Good. Others? Equity more than 15, okay. 15 for last 18 years, okay. 40% or not? It's a typo, I think. 40% and this thing. Nothing has given 40. Shadu, 13 to which one? Okay, any other response? Equity 15, data around 9, 10. Okay. Okay, you have broadly got it correct. So I will show you the numbers. Equity 8, equity is not 8, it is more than 8. Debt 9. So I will show you the numbers. You more or less got it correct. So I have taken the index. Because on an equity, it is easy to calculate. You have the Sensex long history, you have Nifty and all those things, long history. But for debt, we lack a proper index with a long history. So for that, as you can see on screen, I have taken this Nifty index. Now, when I say Nifty, don't think of Nifty 50 only. Nifty as in NSE, they have hundreds of indices, equity, debt, whatever. They have lots of indices. This is the 10-year GSEC index. So taking the 10-year government security as an example, as an illustration, as you can see, this is given 7.2% annualized over a long period. And over the same period, Nifty 50 has given 11.55%. And something technical here, there is something called price return and there is something called total return. So the usual Nifty Sensex we see, that is the price return, means the price of those equity shares in the market. Those companies give dividend also. So dividend yield is like 1.5%. For your total return, you have to add back that also. So you add back dividend return with 11.55, so something like 13-ish approximately. So over a long period, debt has given approximately 7.2, and equity has given approximately 13% as per Nifty total return, adding back the dividend. So yes, equity does give higher returns. So like I said earlier, the essence of diversification is ideally negative correlation, but it is not possible to have perfect negative correlation, even if it is somewhat negative. So as an example, if it is say 60% negative means ULTA, if it is say even 60% ULTA correlation, even that is good for you. In the sense, if it is 60 as an example, it means 60% of the time, equity market goes up, debt market comes down. Debt market goes up, equity market comes down, as an example. And that is how you're actually diversifying your investments. Okay, so this is the thing, building a balanced portfolio. We have already discussed this verbally, negative correlation. And we're talking of two asset classes here, equity and debt. Yes. So this is a long history. I'm showing you year-wise what happened. So this golden line is gold. This this bluish kind of color is equity, and this brown maroon kind of color is debt. So all these years, 2008, 9, 10, 11, 2019, you see what happened in that year from the three asset classes. So 2008, gold gave very good return, 28%. Equity market corrected 52%, means your investments adha ho gaya. Debt gave good 23% return. 2009, equity gave phenomenal 76% return, and debt was negative, -6%. Gold was good, 23%. 2011, gold again good. Equity is negative 24%. Debt is like small 5% positive. So you see the behavior is different. And that is why you should diversify, because if you are invested in only one asset class like equity, your portfolio is subject to the equity market volatility. I'm not saying no to it. If you take a conscious decision that I want to invest 100% of my money into equity, it's okay. You have to have a long horizon, and you have to have the appetite for risk. So, as an example, like I said earlier, January to March 2020, equity market fell by 40%. From those levels, so 23rd March 20 was the bottom. From those levels till today, equity market has not only recovered, it has touched new highs also. But yes, you have to have the appetite for that volatility. Okay, why debt is negative in 2009? So it's a long topic. I'll tell you briefly. In 2008, the global financial crisis broke out. So when the global financial the global financial crisis broke out, the government came out with a relief package, and the government spent more, like they're doing now in the pandemic. So the government required more money, and to fund that, the government's requirement for more money, the government had to borrow heavily in 2009, and the market was not prepared so much of heavy borrowing for the market. Borrowing means what? Supply of more securities. So like in any market, demand supply equation, so more of supply, prices came down, yield levels went up. So in bond, yield and price move inversely. So in 2009, yield levels went up, bond prices came down. That was the reason for negative return in 2009. Default, no, there was no major default. So there were things like real estate, DLF defaulting, Unitech defaulting. But yes, I mean, they did not do any major default like today's, whatever we have seen today, like ILFS, DHFL, Reliance Ambani Group companies. No, there was not such kind of major default. Maybe a little bit of trouble in all those DLF, Unitech kind of companies. Tell the figure and I'll calculate, I will tell you. So will debt be facing similar rise in 2021 due to the growing, that's a good question. Answer is mostly no. The reason is today, the Reserve Bank of India is very supportive. So why they are doing so, what they're doing, it'll take time to explain to you. Maybe I'll do later in the testing question or something. To put it briefly, in those days, 2009, the RBI was like, okay, we are doing our job. Today, the Reserve Bank of India is much more proactive in doing their job. And in spite of such heavy borrowing, yield levels have not moved up and bond prices have not come down because the RBI has been doing a really good job, really proactive thing that even in the face of such high borrowing by the government, yield levels have not, or interest rates have not moved up so much. So what I will do is, and it's good to get questions, it makes the session participative. Let me finish my presentation. Then between Nikhil, me and all of you, we can have an open discussion. Okay, so this is the year-wise thing in equity debt quote. And I will show you one this thing, little bit of a technical numbers, but I'll make it simple for you. What does it mean? The yellowish color, this line is investment in equity. And this yellowish thing is returns. And this brownish, maroonish color is the volatility. And that dotted line, that is the risk-adjusted return. So what is risk-adjusted return? So there is something called standard deviation, which measures the fluctuations around the return. So towards my left, this equity thing. So over a long period of time, had the investment been in equity only, you would have earned 14.3% return. And the volatility, which is measured by something called standard deviation, would have been like 4%. Over the same period, long period, had you invested in debt only, you would have got 9% return, 9.1%. Lower than equity. Volatility also would have been lower, 1.8%. And if you invested in gold, you would have got 11.4%, and volatility would have been highest, 5.3%. Now look at the beauty of diversification. Had you invested in a portfolio of equity and debt combined, 50-50, 50% of portfolio in equity, 50% in debt, your return would have been 11.5%, okay, lower than equity. But your volatility also would have been lower. And this thing called risk-adjusted return, that dotted line, that would have been much better. So equity only, that number is 2, that risk-adjusted return number thing. And here, 50-50 equity debt, that would have been 2.3. And the last one to my right, look at this, 13.2. What is this portfolio? 45% equity, 45% debt, 10% gold. So with a 45-45-10 portfolio, your return would have been 13.2%. Okay, mathematically 13.2 is lower than 14.3. But think of it practically, it is only a little lower. 13.2 is only a little lower than 14.3. Your volatility would have been 2.4, much lower than 4. And your risk adjusted return, adjusted for that volatility, would have been 2.9%. And that is the argument for having a diversified portfolio, having various asset classes. So I'm talking of 3 only, equity, debt, gold. Plus, you may have others like whatever, real estate or other asset classes also. If you have a view, you can go for those also. Laddering we have already discussed. Just to repeat this concept, in financial planning, you have a financial goal like say, foreign trip after 3 years, buying a car after 2 years, buying a house after 10 years. You can earmark in equity also, but in equity, after those 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, your investment is subject to market volatility at that point of time. Whereas in debt, if you buy a bond, maturing on that date, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, it will mature, which means as on that date, after those 2, 5, 10 years, it does not matter the bond market is up or the bond market is down. Because on maturity, your money will come from the company, companies and the company issuing that bond. And you are not subjected to market movements at that point of time. Initially, we spoke about safety. So like we said, if it is a bank, you have to see which bank it is and all that. Now the question of safety in debt funds, yes, they are safe. So why am I saying so? The first argument is the structure of the mutual fund industry. So as per SEBI regulation, the way mutual funds are structured, who holds your money? So unit holders give money to mutual funds, and the securities which are purchased with that money, the securities are held by the custodian. And then the trustee, the board of trustees overseeing the custodian, which means if for the sake of argument, it's not that, but for the sake of argument, even if the AMC were unscrupulous, and even if they wanted to run away with unit holders' money, they cannot do that. The AMC is only the manager. The owner, okay, technically the owner is the unit holders. The board of trustees are there. So the structure is designed well by SEBI. So your investment in mutual fund is subject to market movement. It'll always be there because in mutual funds, you are not investing in the mutual fund. You are investing through the mutual fund. You're investing through the mutual fund into the market. Market can be equity, market can be gold, market can be debt, market can be international equity, global equity. That's a vehicle that is there. But the structure is well designed by SEBI and they cannot run away with your money. Then the question of default, like we said earlier, this ILFS group default, DHFL group default, Reliance and Yes Bank, some instruments defaulted, all these things happened. Yes, there was some impact in mutual funds also, but how much is the impact? So approximately the total default in mutual fund industry is like 18,000 crore. And if we take the AUM, AUM means the assets under management, basically the amount of money being managed by mutual funds. If we divide this 18,000 crore by the amount of money being managed by debt mutual, not even equity, only debt mutual funds, it's like 1% or maybe a little higher than 1%. Approximately 1% is the money being managed. As against that, if you look at the NPA in the banking industry, at one point of time, it was double digit. Now it is like around 7.5 kind of number. But if you compare this 1% with like 7-8% of banking industry, mutual funds have a lower this thing. But yes, even that feels high. Why? In mutual fund, any default is on you. As in if you invest in a mutual fund, the equity market corrected, debt defaulted, it is on you. Whereas in bank, it is on the bank. So if you invest in a bank deposit at whatever rate, 5%, 10%, whatever rate, if the bank has faced NPAs, the bank cannot say, we will give you a return lower than what was contracted because we had NPAs. The bank is contract bound to give you that much, whatever that 5, 10% was contracted. Only in the extreme case, if NPAs become very high, that may toll on the bank itself, the bank invest itself may go bust, whatever, but that does not happen every day. So this is my argument to say mutual funds are safe if you are convinced good, or if you have any doubts, anything, we may discuss in the Q&A session. So we now move on to the next quiz. Which of the following would you prefer from the safety point of view? You can type in the chat box. Corporate bonds, mutual funds, bank deposits. Yes, please type in the chat box. Mutual fund, bank deposit, okay. Okay, corporate bonds, banks, bank deposits, okay. Others, please respond. Okay, so I'll tell you my answer, my view. It is not so much of a black and white case. It is which one, as in within banks. In banks, we have State Bank of India, we have HDFC Bank, we have some other whatever, small cooperative bank in some corner of the country. In corporate bonds, we have AAA, AA, single A, there's a credit rating hierarchy. We have AAA, AA, single A, BBB, and all those things we have. So it is all relative, which one? Which corporate bond or which bank, that is the thing. So I will tell you my points here. It is about the quality. So here you see, I have put rate within a quote. It is all in the rate. So it is like this. Now, I don't mean to say any bank will default or to say any bank is bad or something. But the fact is, if one bank is raising money at 5% and if another bank is raising money at 8%, it means the quality of the loan portfolios are different. For the bank, which is raising money at 5%, raising deposits at 5%, they would be giving out loans at some rate, higher than 5, but whatever, little higher than 5% rate after their margin. A bank which is raising deposits at say 8% rate, they would be giving money, giving loans at a rate higher than 8%, which means the people who have taken loans from this 8-9% wala bank means they were unable to get money from the other bank at 5-6%. So that makes a difference in the portfolio. Now, I don't mean to say that the other bank giving loan at 8-9% will default, because, you know, there are so many kinds of, so many banks, so many entities are there, and defaults doesn't happen every day. Once in a while, like I said, this PMC, Punjab Maharashtra Cooperative Bank. So these things happen. It was a fraud case. It doesn't happen every day. But yes, you have to be mindful about what you're getting into, just to be clear in your own thought that where you're investing and why you're investing. Okay. And there was a question earlier, comparison in the initial phase, comparison between two investments. So in debt mutual fund, one is, of course, the safety aspect. And the other, this thing is, there is a significant tax efficiency in debt mutual fund, provided you hold for 3 years. You have to hold it for 3 years. So earlier, before 2014, it was 1 year. Post 2014, now it is 3 years. You have to hold for 3 years. And how does that tax efficiency generate it? So I'll show you. It is something called indexation. Midhun has a question. In equity, we have different classes, such large, mid, and small. Do we have different? Yes, that's a very appropriate question. Yes, we do have different classes in debt. So as per SEBI categorization, SEBI has categorized 2017. SEBI has given these are the fund categories. So for equity, there is to be 10 categories. Now it is 11, multi-cap, flex-cap, and all those things. So in equity, there are 11 usual categories. In debt, there are 16 categories. And there are 6 hybrid categories. Apart from this 11 equity, 6 hybrid, and 16 debt funds, there are those, what should I say, theme-based or whatever, some idea-based or index fund, all those things are there. On a regular basis, these are the categories. So in debt, as I said, there are 16 categories, starting from liquid overnight fund to whatever, short duration, banking PSU, medium duration, GSEC funds. So there are lots of them. There are 16 funds in debt. What is ELSS? Yes. So ELSS is an equity-oriented fund where the unit holder's money is invested in equities, equity shares, with a 3-year lock-in. So you invest in a ELSS fund. So whatever, like that Section 80C thing. So these things are eligible for this tax efficiency. So there is life insurance policy, there is provident fund, PPF, all these things are there. So along with those, ELSS also is eligible. So whatever money you invest, that much is eligible for that tax efficiency calculation. As of now, there is no debt equivalent of ELSS. In the sense, you have to be there for 3 years. You get the efficiency, but the investment goes into equity, which means your money is subject to equity market volatility. In debt, as of now, we don't have any this thing of getting tax efficiency by investing in a debt thing. Okay, so I will tell you that efficiency, I told you, that is something called indexation, which you get over a holding period of 3 years. Okay, basics of taxation of debt mutual funds or any mutual fund. Dividends, prior to 1st April 2020, there was a defined rate called dividend distribution tax. Post this 1st April 2020, dividends are taxable in your hands at your rate. So whatever tax bracket you are, 30%, 10%, 20%, 40%. 40% means 30% plus surcharge and cess, all those. Whatever bracket you are, you have to pay tax on the dividends from mutual funds at your slab rate. Amirun says, will we be able to get the tax concession during all the 3 years in case of ELSS? No. So like, let us say you take a life insurance policy, or you put a certain amount in PPF, or you put a certain amount in your employees' provident fund. Whatever money you put in that year, in that thing, that is the benefit you get. Same thing for ELSS. So as an example, 1.5 lakh is the thing. Let us say you invest rupees 1 lakh in provident fund, EPF, PPF, and all those things, and rupees 50,000 invest in ELSS. So in that year, rupees 50,000 is eligible for tax efficiency only in that year, not in the other years. Next year, whatever amount you put in or don't put in, whatever, that is the thing relevant for your tax benefit for ELSS. So everything, any of this thing, be it life insurance, be it provident fund, whatever, there's so many things eligible in that. Everything, whatever you put in that year, that is eligible. Fixed deposits and government treasury. So there is something called 5-year special bank deposit. Banks offer this thing. You put in that 5-year bank deposit, and that is eligible under this section. But there is no special government thing. So you can go to your bank and ask them that under that section 80C, if you don't have all these ELSAs or PPF or insurance or whatever, then you can go for this particular tax efficiency wala bank 5-year bank deposit. Okay, so dividends taxable in your hands. So in mutual funds, there are two options, dividend option and growth option. So dividend, the fund declares dividend. And by the way, now the term has changed. Nowadays, it is not called dividend. There's a big word for it, big term for it. Income distribution and capital withdrawal plan. Anyway, whatever that thing is, that is taxable at in your hands at your rate. And there is the growth option. In the growth option, the mutual fund does not pay out anything. Everything is there in the NAV. You invested a certain NAV rate, let us say 11.23 or whatever. After some time, the NAV of the fund grows, that 11.23 becomes like say 12.54 or whatever. So that differential between 11.23 and 12.54, that is your return, NAV to NAV. Okay, there's a question here. How does the taxation matter for a NRI holding debt mutual fund for more than 3 years? I heard debt mutual funds is not efficient for NRI if you already fall in the high tax bracket in India. No, that is not correct. Indexation benefit is available to both Indians and NRIs. There's a subtle difference there. That subtle difference is there is something called TDS or whatever, withholding tax. There's a slight difference there. But the practical difference that happens is that there are some people, some NRIs, who are settled abroad, who earn abroad and file their tax returns abroad and don't have a tax file here. So that you have to have. So as an example, I faced these situations earlier. Let us say you invest in a debt mutual fund. Let's say FMP, fixed maturity plan for 3 years. Being a holding period of 3 years, you are eligible for indexation benefit for 3 years as per regulation. Now, at the point of your maturity or at the point of your redemption, the government has declared indexation number for 2 years only. But as per regulation, you're eligible for 3. Now, what is happening there? Since the government has declared 2 indexation numbers at that point of time, the mutual fund will calculate as per that, as per those 2 indexation numbers declared. For the third thing, though you are eligible for it, you have to claim for it. And claiming for it simply means you have to file taxes here. So if those people who in NRIs, if you are settled abroad, you think, okay, I mean, I don't have nothing much in India, I don't file tax and all that, then you are foregoing it. So all those tax things are there, but as per regulation, this indexation benefit in debt mutual fund over a holding period of 3 years is available to both resident Indians and NRIs also. So there is no differentiation there, apart from the TDS thing. Okay, so the growth option, it is taxable in your hands at your slab rate. So there's something called short term, something called long term. So this thing for 3 years, it's called long-term capital gain. So if you invest in a debt mutual fund growth option, 3 years, that is eligible for indexation benefit. If it is less than 3 years holding period, that is not long-term, that is short-term. And short-term is taxable at your slab rate, whatever 30% tax rate you are in. For long-term, after indexation benefit, the tax rate is 20% only, but effectively, by virtue of the benefit of this indexation thing, effectively, depending on numbers declared by the government, the tax rate becomes very low, like 5 or 7% only post-indexation. Okay, question from Parthiv. Can we switch MF taken through DMAT account from regular to direct in the same DMAT account? I have to check. Maybe Nikhil can answer that later. It's an operational thing. Can we switch MF taken through DMAT account from regular to direct? So I will complete my thing, operational thing. I think Nikhil will address this later. Okay, so these are the tax rates applicable from 1st April 2020, but still valid. So what rates do we have for equity funds? Long-term capital gain is holding period of 1 year only, 3 years for debt, for equity it is 1 year. Equity you hold 1 year, you become eligible for long-term capital gain. The rate is 10%, and that too, up to 1 lakh is free. Up to 1 lakh of capital gain in equity shares and equity mutual fund is free. Beyond 1 lakh of capital gain, you pay tax at 10% only. Other than equity means basically debt funds or whatever. LTCG rate, the number you see there is 20%. But there you get indexation benefit. And as I said, post the indexation benefit, as in whatever numbers are declared by the government, the effective tax rate on your returns falls to as low as like 5 or 7% or whatever, 5, 7, 8, 9, that kind of thing. Siva says, what is the ideal time frame to hold money in a debt fund? So the beauty is, you know, like I said earlier, there are those 16 debt funds, and there is a debt fund to suit your investment horizon. So if your investment horizon is very short, like a few days only, or it could be a few months, it could be a few years. So there is an appropriate debt fund for every this thing. So if it is, if your horizon is say only a few days, there is something called overnight fund, there's something called liquid fund. If your horizon is say a few months only, there is something called ultra short term fund, something called low duration fund, then something called money market fund. If your horizon is a few years, then there is short duration fund, there is banking PSU fund, there's corporate bond fund. For a long horizon, there is government securities funds and all those things are there. In equity, even though there are various categories like large cap, mid cap, small cap, and whatever various caps are there, whatever cap you are into in equity, you have to have a long horizon. If you have a short horizon of say 6 months, if you invest today in 6 months, if the market rallies, good for you. What if the market corrects? Nobody knows. So that way for equity, whichever fund you're going into, you have to have a long horizon, ideally. Whereas in debt, there is a fund suitable for your horizon. What is indexation and how is calculated? So wait for a few minutes. I have it in my thing. I'll show you how it is calculated. Okay. So as you see here, withholding tax rate. So for resident, there is a withholding tax of 10%, and for NRIs it is 20%. Now, this TDS or withholding tax is different. Before 1st of April 2020, we had this thing called dividend distribution tax. Now, DDT and TDS or withholding tax is different. Why? DDT is like in those days, once DDT is deducted, you can't do anything. As in whatever returns the fund has earned, net of that dividend distribution tax, the mutual fund will pay you and you can't do anything about it. You cannot claim a refund. Even if you are a, let us say a tax-free trust, even if you are a senior citizen, not earning much, and you are in a 0% tax bracket, even then, in those days, dividend option, dividend distribution tax, kat gaya to kat gaya. Whereas in TDS, any TDS, any of your income, as you know, that is adjustable. As in you can talk to your CA that so much of TDS has been deducted and this is my income, this is the tax I have to pay. And that TDS is adjustable. So now it is a more innocuous version. It is TDS and not that DDT of earlier days. So for NRIs, there is a higher TDS or withholding tax rate, that's all. It is only a TDS thing. The new tax slab, new as not very new. It came last year, as in the budget presented in February 2020. The finance minister proposed these rates. You have the option A, option B. So option B, apparently the rates are lower, but in option B, you don't get the benefit of all the, like we said, ATC and all that. Don't get the benefit of all those tax saving investments and all that. So you can talk to your CA which one is better for you. So both are available, both options are there. Okay. So now we come to this thing called indexation. What is this indexation? So there is a number called cost inflation index, CII. This number is declared by the government. Government has in CBDT. CBDT stands for Central Board of Direct Taxation. So this CBDT, they announce the number every year. And as per that, you can do the calculation. I'll show you one or two illustrations. So there was an old series. So if you want to see these numbers, you can easily do a Google. It is available, but just to mind you on this thing, if you are getting it through Google, you have to avoid the old numbers. So this is the old series, 81, 82 as the base. This has been replaced. Don't go by these numbers. I'm showing you the, why is it not moving? Huh. So these are the new numbers. So in the new series, you see 2001-2 is the base 100. So they have changed all those numbers. They have made 2001-2 as the starting point, and 2-3 and all those starting from 100 onwards. These are the new numbers. These are relevant. And if you're doing a Google, you take these numbers. So even for 21-22, this financial year, they have given this number. 2001, 200, 2, 3, 105 and all that. So till this 317 is the number for this year. This you can easily get through Google. I'm just showing you here. And you can do your own calculation. Or if you cannot, you can ask your CA. Okay, so how it is calculated? I'm showing you one example. So as an illustration, Amit Gupta invested in an FMP on 25th March 2013. It matured on 17th August 2016. So 3 years complete from March 13 to August 16, more than 3 years, first criteria. Starting NAV was 10 and last NAV was 12.5. So what is this? Long-term capital gains tax. So there is a year of purchase, 2012-13. So as per the old series, the CII, as in the cost inflation index, was 852. And redemption was, maturity or redemption was August 16. So 16-17 is the financial year. In 16-17, as per the old series, that number was 1125. The number is in that CII, that cost inflation index number. So indexation is 1125 by 852. So 1.32 to 10, 13.2. Since index cost is more than the redemption NAV, there is no tax. So my indexed purchase cost is 13.2 and my terminal redemption maturity value is 12.5, so there is no tax. And in the new series, in 2016-17, that number is 264, that CII number. And 12-13, that number is 200. So again, the government has maintained the same number, same benefit in the new series as well. I'll show you another example. Komal Nahar invested in this fund on 5th April 2013. She redeemed on 17th August 2016. Starting NAV 10, redemption NAV 12.5. So I have kept the numbers same. I have changed only one thing, the investment date. So here you see the investment date was March 13, 25th March 13, and here it is 5th April 13. Only a few days of difference. But within those few days, what has changed? Financial year. We have come to the next financial year. So here the year of purchase was 13-14. The number there was 939. 16-17, same thing, 1125. So 1125 by 939. So that 1.198. So 11.98 is my indexed cost. My sale value 12.5, indexed cost 11.98. So 10 becomes 11.98. My gain is so much, 0.52. On that 0.52, I pay at 20% rate. So effectively the tax I pay is very low. Same thing in the new series, 264 by 220. So similar this thing. A similar benefit the government has maintained in the new series as well. So the tax efficiency makes mutual funds better than deposits over 3 year horizon, provided the deposit is not very high. So if the mutual fund is giving like say whatever, 6% return, as an example. If the bank deposit also is giving you a similar kind of return, mutual fund is better. But if the bank deposit is giving you a very high rate, then it's a different issue. So one example here, I have taken the same rate of return for the sake of comparison. So if the initial thing is rupees 100, and if the mutual fund is giving you 5% return over a 3 year period, your terminal NAV becomes 115.76. So 5% every year plus compounding. So 115.76. At the assumed rate of indexation, I've assumed 4%. Your indexed cost is 112. Taxable component 3.28, taxed at 20%. So net of tax, you get 4.8% return. So as against 5% return in the mutual fund, net of taxation, you get as high as 4.8, as in your tax is very nominal because you get the benefit of indexation. Same thing, bank deposit. Bank deposits are always taxable as interest and there is no indexation benefit. So 5%, I've assumed same return, and tax rate is 30%, assuming you're in 30% bracket. You get 3.55% return. So 5 net of your taxation at 30% bracket becomes 3.55%. So at a similar rate of return, mutual funds over a 3-year horizon score over bank deposits. So that is more or less about my PPT as such. We will, in 2 minutes, we'll open for an open discussion. I'm showing you my books. So the hard copies are all there on Amazon and Flipkart. So you can just go to like you buy any goods, anything from Amazon, Flipkart. You can click there and you can buy any of these books. The first one towards my right is the fixed income thing, fixed income markets in India. The second one is mutual funds. This is second edition. Third edition also will come out in some time. Only this one is available on in soft copy and Kindle. Third one is non-finance. It's called Open Your Eyes. The fourth one, the one on my left, is wealth management. And the fifth one, the one you see, financial planning and wealth management. The fourth and fifth books are overlapping. The fourth one, wealth management, the blue blackout, blue color kind of cover. That is what I wrote, what came to my mind. And this one, the last one, financial planning and wealth management, is as per the university syllabus. The publisher said there is no book on this. So 50% content is overlapping. So if you want to learn about wealth management, you can purchase any of this, book 4 or book 5, as in wealth management, blue cover, or this one, financial planning. About debt mutual funds, the one you see, the second from my right, mutual funds in India, that is about debt mutual funds. And fixed income markets in India, the one to my right, the bluish kind of cover, fixed income markets in India. And these are the links. You can just do a search on Amazon, Flipkart, or you can use these links also. You can click on the link and you get this thing on Amazon, Flipkart. So Shroff is the publisher. You can go to Amazon website, Flipkart website, or Shroff publisher's website also. So I think, yes, the most coveted site, slide on a presentation. Thank you, slide. So I think that's about it. So Nikhil, should I stop sharing the screen? We can have a discussion now.
Yeah, you can stop sharing the screen. I think, thank you so much. In Amazon, if you want to check for the books, the best way is that just go and type in the Joydeep Sen, then you will be able to see that what are the books under this order. So that way it will be easier to find. Thank you so much, sir, for conducting this session. I think this is a very big eye-opener for everyone. And the concepts were, I don't think that people must have been really thought about this when they were getting into FD. I think they were just without thinking much, they are investing, and now you kind of open their eyes such a way that they have to look so many things when you invest. I think the first question itself was too much of confusion, or I don't know whether everyone understood that off and on difference really. So that is the reason you are getting a mixed answer, because I'm sure that everyone was like on and off. It was a confusion. I don't know whether everyone really understood very clearly. I'm just asking you Malayalam. നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഫസ്റ്റ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ചോദിച്ചതെന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ വളരെ സിമ്പിൾ ആയിട്ട് ഒരു ഫിക്സ്ഡ് ഇൻകം പൈസ ഇട്ട് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ആ ഇട്ട പൈസ തിരിച്ചു കിട്ടണോ അതിൽ നിന്ന് കിട്ടണ റിട്ടേൺ കിട്ടണോ എന്നാണ് ചോദിച്ചത്. So that's a very important thing, that whether you want to get the whatever deposited money or just a return. So it's a very important thing, because we have more than return. We need to make sure that whatever 10 lakh or 1 crore rupees we put, that money we have to get it for the interest. So it's a very eye-opener question. And I think everything is covered, taxing. And we talked about investing in other banks and everything. So, sir, actually, we have almost... crossed 1 hour, but can you just spend at least 10-15 extra, because we will have a lot of questions coming from people. I think before throwing into the session, so we almost all these questions you have covered that time, but I think that there will be questions from people that I'm getting this treasury bond, and because treasury in Kerala we get about 8.5% or more, close to 8%, And so everyone's question is that, should I go for that or should I go for other public sector bank or mutual fund? So this is a question people in our community will have, especially initially when Krishnamurthy sir was asking this question. So can you just throw light on this and then I'll take other questions.
Sure. So first of all, I have to understand from you only, Nikhil. So this treasury bond, when you say treasury bond, usually treasury means the government.
It's not so treasury bond. We have a treasury in Kerala treasury. We have a facility to deposit fixed income, fixed deposit over there. So for right. that, we are getting higher return. So
So what is that rate? Higher return as in what is the rate they're giving?
It's 8%.
Oh, 8%.
Yeah.
Oh, that is difficult to beat through mutual funds. If it is actually giving 8% and if it is safe. So I don't know. So you can tell me what is the safety aspect? If it is by the kind of guaranteed by the government, then it is safe.
Yeah. So this is, it is, when I think there is a lock-in period is there. That is one. Krishnamurthy sir, are you there? You want to ask specific questions on this?
Yeah. This is actually for more than 2 years, government of Kerala. They say it is backed by the government of Kerala, 7.5% interest. So my question is, I am 30% slab rate. So my question is whether I should put my, it is better for me to go for this government treasury fixed deposit or safe PSU, banking and PSU fund.
Okay, I got the question. And
considering the 30% slab. 7.5% interest. Here, I don't expect that much return in PSU.
Right. I got the question. So what you can do is a simple calculation. So if you're comfortable with Excel, you can do it in Excel. Or if you can simply whatever, with pen, paper, calculator, whatever way you're comfortable, you can do the calculation. So for the treasury deposit, 7.5 is taxable at 30%. So 7.5 minus 30% is your net return from the treasury deposit. Whereas in a banking PSU mutual fund, it will be much lower than that. So I don't know how much. That's a 5% as an example. As an example, 5% is your return from the banking PSU good quality mutual fund scheme. And after a holding period of 3 years, that banking PSU fund is taxable at 20% post-indexation. Okay. Now, over the next 3 years, how much inflation will be and how much benefit the government will give is anybody's call. For the sake of discussion, let us say it is 4% as an example. We are assuming 4% inflation, which means 5% is my return from that banking PSU mutual fund thing. 4% is the benefit given by the government, which means my taxable is 1%. And on that 1%, my tax rate is 20%. So I pay only 20 paisa tax. Which means my 5% return becomes how much? 4.8, right?
Yes, good.
Yeah, 4.8. Whereas that 7.5 minus, I can do it right now. So I'll do it here. So 7.5 into 30% is 2.25. 7.5 minus 2.25. It's 5.25, right, Nikhil? I'm getting 5.25.
Correct.
Right. So as of now, that treasury thing, even after paying 30% tax, is higher. Now, why is this anomaly? What has happened is over past like 2 years or so, RBI has cut interest rates. So bank deposit rates, mutual funds. So in mutual fund, there's something called portfolio YTM. You can go to the site of any mutual fund, download their fact sheet, and the fact sheet, you can see this thing called portfolio YTM. And that is used by people as a ballpark indication of how much returns you may get. The portfolio YTM of all debt funds are lower today than it was, say, 2 years ago. So as an example, 2 years ago, if you were seeing, like, say, 7.5% in the treasury deposit, and if the portfolio YTM of a banking PSU fund was, say, 7%, that was better. 7%, 3 year holding period, indexation benefit, net of tax, you are better off.
Yeah, that is correct.
But today, since the portfolio item is low, 5% or whatever that number is, even after the indexation benefit, because the gap is wide, this is 7.5, that is like 5 or whatever number that is, because the gap is wide, today, treasury deposit is better. So that way. So maybe after 1 year or 2 years, if RBI hikes rates, situation may reverse after 1 or 2 years.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Yeah. Hope you got the answer. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I got it. Thanks.
And sir, I think we need to discuss a few things. Which when we it comes to debt mutual fund, we have this tendency that we people who invest directly, they have a tendency to go and see that what is a maximum return given in the last 3 years, I will go and put the money there. I'm not really bothered about debt or anything. I'm, for me, that's a mutual fund. And there is a government return, gilt. So that means that is good. So when we choose debt funds, we have a gilt, we have a corporate, we have a bank and PSU, and we have liquid funds. So is it in a very easy way, why we need to look that and why we need to choose specifically according to the risk and tenure? If you can quickly mention that, it will be really good for the people.
So firstly, you would have heard this n number of times, you know, that disclaimer language goes into those mutual funds and other investments, past returns, not a guarantee for future and all those things. And that is a fact. Mm. What is the difference? If in a bank deposit or any deposit, whatever they're giving is, like I said, contractual. Some people say guaranteed. No, it's not guaranteed. It's contractual. So you're putting money in a 5% deposit or 10% deposit. You know, I will get 5 or 10%. Whereas in a market-oriented investment can be directly buying equity shares from the market, could be buying bonds, could be buying mutual fund, PMS scheme, anything. In a market-oriented investment, your returns in future depends on the market. So it is not a bank fixed deposit. It depends on the market. And market can go any which way. Market can go up, good for you. Market can come down, bad for you. So what people do is, people tend to, like you said, extrapolate. So in the last 3 years, it has given so much. Next 3 years, also it will give that much. That is wrong. So it is like this. Like I give the example of January to March 2020. Somebody investing in equity shares or equity mutual fund in January 2020, he or she would have looked at equity mutual fund returns over the previous whatever, 1 year, 3 years, 10 years, whatever, and would have gone into equities. And somebody investing in March 2020 in equities would have looked at the past whatever, those 3 month returns, 40% correction, 40% market down, would have seen that thing. But as we know, today, in hindsight, we know that Jan to March was an aberration, market corrected 40%. And from those levels, if you look at large cap stocks from March 2020 till today, large cap has given like approximately 70-80% return. Small cap has given 130% return. It has made up for the loss and given much higher. So like the warning says, that punchline says, past returns are not an indication of future returns. So forget that. So if that is not relevant, what do I look at? In equity, there is no proper this thing to look at. Whereas in debt, what I said earlier, that portfolio volume is a ballpark indication. It is very easy. What you have to do is, whatever mutual fund you are thinking of, go to the website of that mutual fund, download the fact sheet, portfolio fact sheet from there, and whichever fund you are thinking of, they will give that portfolio volume. That portfolio volume is not a guarantee, but it is only an indication, but it gives some indication. Like this gentleman asked sometime earlier, if in a banking PSU fund, good quality fund, if the portfolio volume is say 5%, over a holding period, you may expect something around 5%. That is the ballpark indication. So this portfolio volume is at least a better indication than last 3 year return or last whatever return. Next point, about the gilt fund, which you mentioned now, in times of rally in the market. Now in the debt market, rally means what? In debt market, rally means interest rates coming down, yields coming down, because yield and price move inversely. So when there's a rally in the debt market, the interest rate yields are coming down, prices are going up. People tend to get attracted. Oh, last 1 year or last 3 years, gilt has given whatever, 10%, 20% return, and there's no risk. People tend to go by that. Now, please remember, in government security funds, gilt funds, there is no credit risk because it is issued by the government of India, but there is interest rate risk. Why? So this thing called interest rate risk or market risk is, in bond, there's a metric called something called duration. Higher the duration, higher is the volatility. And in those 16 debt funds, government security funds have the longest duration. So government security funds are the most volatile. So in the past 1 year, as an example, if there's a rally in the gilt market and gilt funds have given like 16% return, if the market corrects over the next, whatever, 1 year, and if interest rates move up, then it will not get good returns. Okay, next point. Then am I de-recommending gilt funds? No, I'm not de-recommending. The requirement is a long investment horizon. If you have a 10-year investment horizon, you can safely invest in gilt funds. Why? There is no credit risk. The issuer is the government of India. And all these things like market cycles, interest rates going up, coming down, blah, blah, whatever happening. Over a long period of, say, 10 years, everything settles down. So for some time, it may so happen, okay, last 1 year, whatever, 16%, 6%, next 1 year, whatever, 6%, 16%. Over a long horizon of 5, 10, 15 years, things even out, things settle down, and you will get good returns. So all I'm saying is, gilt funds, yes, if you have a long horizon of 10 years or whatever, just go and invest and forget the short term. Some short term means if it so happens and you invest next 3 months, the market corrects and you get 0% return, don't worry. Just stay invested. Stay invested for those 10 years and you will get decent returns in a gilt fund. Okay. So does that answer the question?
Yeah. I think it is a good thing, because the point here we want to drive is that, you know, there is a difference. And when you go for debt fund, we have to really look at it, because we have always get this question. I have invested, it was a past return was good. Then when we ask, we will get to know that this was a corporate bond or this was a gilt fund. Their horizon was 1 year. But they looked at the past 3 years' performance and they invested it. And one more thing, we have a tendency to go for this NCDs here, because we have some gold companies and gold lending companies, and they issue NCDs. So is it good to go for NCDs with 8% or 8% more plus in interest rate, coupon rate? And what is the risk involved in that kind of investment?
Okay. One point, the previous thing, just to, that before starting this point, one point about the previous one, at the cost of repetition, if your horizon is short, there is an appropriate fund for that horizon also. So like I said, in gilt funds, you require a long horizon of 10 years. If your horizon is 1 year, there is an appropriate fund for 1 year also. For an example, money market fund. In a money market fund, you can safely invest for 1 year and we will not be subjected to so much of fluctuation. So you can pick and choose the appropriate category of funds. Okay. Now, coming to your question, in one word, yes. In fact, what we can do is, Nikhil, after some time, we can do a similar session on bonds also. Like today, we're discussing safety. We are discussing debt mutual funds. We can have a session on bonds also as to which are the bonds available in the market, how to understand, how to trade, and how to invest in bonds. So those things we can discuss in another call, because it'll take time to invest. But yes, to cover it quickly, you can. So it is like this, like I said earlier, when I said one bank is taking deposits at 5% and another bank taking at 8%, it is not to say that the 8% bank will default. It is just that you have to be aware that the risk level is different. That's all. So as an example, if State Bank of India is taking deposit at 5% and some other bank is taking deposit at 8%, as long as you have comfort with that bank, you know the people there, you know their portfolio, loan quality and all those things. And if you have the comfort, you can deposit there also. So similarly, like you said, gold loan companies, in fact, you will know better because, you know, I stay at Bombay and those companies are Kerala based. You will know them better. As long as you know the companies and as long as you have comfort factor, yes, you can invest. In fact, I'll tell you something, you know, this debate has been happening at least in Bombay investment circles. This Muthoot, Manappuram, are they good, are they bad, and all those things. That debate has been going on for quite a long time. I think the biggest argument against that is that, what if there is a fall in gold prices? Mm-hmm. The answer to that is, the loan given is at a margin, right? And if you look at history, even though we have had some pockets of gold price correction, we have not had a very sustained period of gold price correction. So as an example of this margin, as an example, if the person is depositing rupees 100 worth of gold, the loan given out is say rupees 70, which means your margin is 30%. So for that gold company to be without margin at a risk, firstly, the gold price has to fall that much from 100 to 70 and below so that the company goes without margin. And secondly, there is an emotional attachment. People will not make a one-to-one mathematical calculation. Oh, gold price has fallen, so I'm better off. I will not repay the loan or whatever those things. People have an emotional thing with gold. People will not do that. Okay? And it is very, very unlikely that there will be a sustained period of 30% correction in gold. Rather, it so happens when gold price goes up. The gold is worth 100 rupees. Loan given is 70 rupees. If the price goes up, that 100 becomes 120. Effectively, the margin becomes 50%. As against 120 rupees worth of gold, the loan given is 70 rupees. The margin effectively goes up. That is one. Second point is, you know, these companies, they have a very good internal audit structure. Because this business works on the, not only on the trust and faith of the people, the employees, the staff at the various branches. That is, of course, there. That trust, faith, that known circles, those things to manage. Plus, there's insurance. Plus, they have a very good internal control and internal audit system. So that way, everything is very well controlled.
Okay.
So that way, I don't see any major issue in this gold loan company. Yes.
Okay.
You have comfort and you can invest in those companies.
Okay. Okay. And don't worry, since we have Kerala and Kerala ladies, they won't allow to get the gold out. So that guarantee also we know. Okay. And sir, when we get into allocation, because we invest in a long-term equity, and what is the kind of importance or what is the kind of allocation we need to have in that portfolio? You know, what should be the debt component in the long-term equity SIP or a portfolio?
Yeah. So it's not a one-word answer. It depends on the person's investment objective, investment horizon, the person's risk profile, and so many other things. For that particular person, to give you the answer as a ballpark, the ballpark used in the industry is 100 minus age for equity. So as an example, if it is a 30-year-old person, assuming that the person has disappeared because he or she is young, and being 30-year-old, he has a long horizon also, he or she may have 70% equity as a ballpark. 50-year-old person, 50% equity. 70-year-old person, 30% equity. That is the ballpark. But yes, subject to the individual person's risk appetite and horizon and all those things. So even for a 30-year-old person, if he says, I want to buy a bike in say, 6 months, for that 6 months, that should not go into equities. That should go into debt. Whatever amount the person says, I'm doing an SIP with a 10-year horizon, 20-year horizon, that can go into equities, that one with a long horizon. So like you are into this business of financial advisory, financial planning. So accordingly, you can do the planning. What is the, so for the same customer, same client, the long-term money can go into equities, short-term money can go into debt. For the long term, also, like I showed that diversification thing I showed you year-wise. Mm-hmm. Some year equity is positive, some year equity is negative, equity, debt, gold. So diversification helps. Diversification helps in getting a less of volatility in the portfolio. Like in that phase of Jan to March 2020, in case a person had a 100% equity portfolio, no issues. Market has recovered more than that loss. Mm-hmm. But in that phase, he or she would have had a sleepless night because the market is correcting so much. Had it been a 70-30 portfolio, 70% equity, at least 30% of the portfolio would have been whatever, stable. So that is the meaning about volatility. So accordingly, as per the person's investment objectives and profile and horizon, you can do an allocation between equity and debt.
And I think it needs a lot of a discussion with the client and understand all things. And when it comes to, there is one question. What is your advice in asset allocation, a percentage, example, equity, mutual fund, real estate, and gold? But I know that it's not a straightforward answer, but if you can put your thoughts.
So like we discussed in the previous discussion, So first of all, don't look at mutual fund as mutual funds. Mutual fund is equity or debt or hybrid, because mutual fund, like I said earlier, you don't invest in mutual funds. You invest through mutual funds. So through a mutual fund, investing in equity, investing in debt or gold or hybrid or international equity. So like I said earlier, so if you are, say, a 40-year-old, you may have, say, 60% in equity, or if you may classify that way, risk assets, as in more volatile assets. If we say equities or gold is a risk asset because it is subject to more volatility, you may have 60% in risk assets. So 60% maybe say 50% equity, 10% gold, and 40% in debt. So that broadly is the classification. By the way, sometimes debt also can be volatile. Like we saw 2009, like someone asked, why did debt give negative? But generally, debt is less volatile than equity. And within debt, like I said, gilt can be more volatile. If your horizon is short, money market fund, liquid fund, ultra short term fund, they are less volatile. So your cash component means emergency kind of thing. That you may put in as, say, whatever, liquid fund or ultra short term fund kind of thing. Other component, like someone said, banking pension fund, those kind of good quality funds you can keep.
Okay. Because we had a huge demand last year for gilt, because we were only looking at that percentage of return given in the last 1 year. And then followed up with the government word also attached. So if I can get a government backed with a higher rate, I want only that. And so that is another issue. And when it comes to guaranteed investments, because we have a demand for guaranteed investment, especially when it comes to retirement. So we have a lot of schemes in insurance companies, a guaranteed investment scheme. So what is your view in terms of planning for retirement? How do we allocate debt funds? Or should we advise clients to go for insurance guaranteed investment scheme? So what is your take on that point of that kind of investors?
So on the insurance guarantee thing, guarantee means in the sense that they are committing. It's not a guarantee asset, but they're committing that if you invest in this insurance scheme, investment insurance policy, over a period of these many years, you will get like whatever, 6% as an example, 6.5, whatever that number is, you will get this thing, they're committing. So yeah, it is generally there in the sense that I don't know the legal standing of that, but at least when an insurance company of a known brand, accepted brand like, say, HDFC or ICICI or Bajaj or whichever brand, or Tata, whatever, when a company of the known brand like HDFC, ICICI, Tata, they are committing, like if you invest in this, you will get 6.3% annualized. So that should be acceptable people. That's not an issue. What you have to compare here is, like you said, retired persons. You have to see how much of liquidity is required. In the sense, in a mutual, let us say retired person has 1 crore and that's all he has. So he says, I have worked all life and I have saved 1 crore rupees. And with that, I have to pass my next, whatever, 10, 20, 30 years. If you invest that in a mutual fund, as in multiple mutual funds, equity, debt, whatever, in multiple mutual funds, and if you do an SWP, as in systematic withdrawal plan, there you have flexibility. In an SWP, you can define, I want to withdraw rupees 50,000 per month, or whatever amount of rupees per month. In case you want to stop that, you can stop that. In case you require lump sum, suddenly something happens, you have to withdraw rupees 20 lakhs. You can do that, it is your money. So all those SWPs, you can increase, decrease, stop, whatever. Any withdrawal, any fresh deposit, whatever you can do, it's your thing, it's flexible. Whereas in insurance, the flexibility is less. So it is like this, if a known brand, like I said, HDFC, ICICI, Tata, or somebody, Bajaj, if they're giving a commitment of whatever, 6%, 6.5% return, that should be acceptable. But in insurance, the flexibility is less. So what is the meaning of flexibility is less? In a similar example, after 6 months, if the senior citizen says, I require rupees 20 lakh for some emergency, out of that 1 crore money, so in insurance, you have this thing called annuity. Annuity means you give rupees 1 crore to the insurance company like LIC. And they will say, we will give you rupees so much per month forever, as in still you live or your spouse lives. Mm-hmm. They actually give that. There is no doubt in that. once you buy an annuity from a mutual fund, if you say, I suddenly required rupees 20 lakhs, out of those you take it away, out of that 1 crore, you give me 20 lakhs back. That flexibility is not there in insurance industry.
Okay.
You have entered an agreement. Okay, I had 1 crore, I have given you the 1 crore to LIC. LIC is, of course, Government of India. And they will keep on giving you that whatever committed amount, rupees so much per month, till you live or whatever the term says. You'll get that. But flexibility is less.
Okay. I think it's all about your kind of planning and making sure that that buffer is there. If you have that kind of a buffer, yes, go for this. Otherwise, we need to be really, really thought about it and invest. Right?
Yes. So like you said, okay. If you have, let us say, 1.5 crore in this example.
Almost crossed half an hour. Yeah. You're adding something. Yeah.
What I was saying is, so in this example, if you have, say, 1.5 crore, with 1 crore you buy LIC annuity, that you are sure to get till you live. If that 50 lakh rupees, if you put into some mutual fund or some other deposit or some other avenue, and if that is liquid, you know that for any emergency requirement of money, you can access that. So all those planning you can do.
Yeah. Okay. There is one, I'll just get into the chat room. So for NRE customers, which is better, NRE FD, which is tax-free, or debt fund, which is having tax? I think that answer which you have said, when you calculate, I think NRE only will work out.
If it is tax-free.
Yeah.
In fact, we also face this thing that an NRE asking a debt mutual fund so much is the indication. YTM is so much, whereas this deposit is tax-free. So let's look at the bank, which bank FD you are taking. Any good bank, of course.
I think what you said is, this is mix of your two answers, because the LIC issue also happens here, because this is a 1 year commitment you have. If you are breaking with before 1 year, you won't get any interest. So before investing, you should know that what is the kind of a liquidity you want. Then bit of a planning, I think you can ensure that you earn a return. It's not about paying tax. It's about what is your requirement and how you want to play around. Okay.
Yes.
I think there are questions coming in. I think I have invested some amount in ICICI Pru All Seasons Fund in 17. Today 8.5. Should I hold or switch? Okay. I think that hold or switch investment, I think we don't have to. What's your take on that last question?
You can hold.
Yeah.
So you have to switch funds. No, don't switch funds every day.
Yeah.
Only if there's a sustained period of underperformance, only then you can think of switching. Otherwise, every fund goes through periods of whatever. So you can just hold on.
Yeah. I think it's a valid point. I think. Okay. I think we are more than we have taken about half an hour from especially Joydeep sir. Thank you so much extending that half an hour. Also, I think this session, I'm sure that everyone have got a different thought. And in fact, the questions which I plan to ask is not really, I have really covered, because, I think as you said, I think if the time permit, viewers, I think we will conduct one more session. I think that time we will have a little more question answer session. I think that will be great, because I think your kind of wisdom is something which is needed for people to practically use the investment, because actually everyone learn about product now, but what is that applicability in terms of my real life? That is what is more needed. So I think thank you so much. Before that closing, that do you have any final advice for this audience as a closing remark? I hope I know the questions. You understood that what kind of audience we have. So if you can give that a final remark, it will be great.
So the quality of questions have been actually good, because I do sessions all over India. And, sometimes people tend to confuse even basic concepts. That's why the quality of questions has been good and the audience is evolved. So there is no particular special advice as such. I think going by the trend of the discussion, people have already understood what are the parameters. So like just at the cost of repetition, I would say higher return does not mean default. Only that if something comes to your mind, in fact, I'll just give you an example. ILFS. ILFS was a AAA rated quasi PSU company. They defaulted. Whereas there are certain real estate companies I've been hearing for a long time that the company is in trouble, but those companies are still there, surviving. So what will happen? Nobody knows. So it is like this, if you are depositing against the State Bank of India at say 5%, the possibility of a State Bank of India surviving after whatever, 5 years or 10 years is like 99.999% or 100%, whatever. If you're investing in a 8% deposit thing, be it a bank or beating a company, bond, whatever it is, not to say they will default, only that as against that 99.99%, the possibility of that surviving is a little lower, whatever, 90, 97, 96, whatever that number is. As long as you are taking a conscious call, yes, I have seen that company, I know the company, and for these reasons, I have comfort, yes, you can just go and invest. So I think, like we discussed now, after some time, we can have a session on bonds. And there we will discuss that this market risk thing.
Yeah.
Like I said, in Guild Fund, there is no credit risk, but there's a market risk. As in the fluctuation thing, risk is there. If you buy a direct bond, and if you hold it till maturity, there is no market risk.
Mm-hmm.
We call it HTM, hold to maturity. There is no market risk there. So maybe we can continue after some time with that discussion on how to invest in bonds directly.
Yeah, I think we need to talk about that market-linked debentures also.
Yeah, we'll do that. Yeah, higher, yeah.
And perpetual bond. I think that will have a more interest here, because we had a South Indian Bank perpetual bond before, and we had a lot of queries. I think that kind of a discussion, it will add a lot of value to people. So I think as of today's thing, I'm very grateful to all the effort which you have taken for us. And this is not like we are getting just a theory knowledge. This is like a practical wisdom of 25 years. So it's like this 1 hour is actually a capsule kind of a thing for the just 24 years of experience. So thank you so much. I think on my behalf and my audience behalf, I want to acknowledge the love and thank you for this. And this audio will be shared in our record also. So this will be not end here. This will be seen over a period of time, and we will get a lot of questions on that. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So one last word. I know one Malayalam word.
Nanni. yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming and taking active part on this. Thank you.